I find myself in an awkward headspace, that of simultaneously feeling like I have a lot to say, and like every blow I have to add to the dead horse that is Skyrim discourse has been done a thousand times before. There are creators on this platform who have made a career out of ostensibly reading Elder Scrolls lore directly from the wiki. And after all, why shouldn't they? It's not like Bethesda's going to do it in their games. But I accept that jest is in bad taste, and I don't want to create unnecessary sour grapes before I even start this odyssey. Skyrim is a lot of things to a lot of people. I genuinely cannot tell if Skyrim is the best game I hate or the worst game I love, and it and its derivatives have made me feel something. Not quite tangible, and it perturbs me in a way only the inconsequential actions of creators can. I recall one poignant moment at the end of my first playthrough. I just read on Reddit that if I toggled noclip and walk into the skybox, I could see the Imperial City off Skyrim's southern border. So, of course, that's exactly what I did. I walked to the edge of the war border, toggled noclip, and walked up. In that moment, I felt longing, as if the answers to everything unfinished to Skyrim lay just over the border, that I was one loading screen away from fulfillment, and despite my best efforts, it was one loading screen too far. Cyrodiil may as well have been on the surface of the moon. I'll warn the viewer now that this video isn't about Skyrim in the way anyone would use that term. This isn't a narrative deconstruction. It's not how I would fix Skyrim. Hell, it's not even a Skyrim explained. It's about me and my attempts to understand why media that I nominally dislike affects me so strongly. We will talk about Skyrim a lot, but it's a bit of a hike before we talk about why I think Skyrim plays like diaspora-flavored Sprite would taste. Skyrim makes me feel weird, and I don't know how to process it. My first fantasy world was the Kanto region as presented by Pokemon Yellow. Special thanks to my friend Amber for letting me borrow her Game Boy Pocket over 20 years ago. It wouldn't be until several years later in the fourth grade that I got my own Nintendo handheld. I shared my fourth grade classroom with that teacher's kids, and through some turn of events lost at time, I was given his hand-me-down Game Boy Pocket. Remember that this would have been about the time Pokemon Ruby and Sapphire came out, so the Game Boy Advance had well and truly replaced the Pocket as the new hotness. I can still remember bringing that Game Boy home and begging my parents for two AAA batteries. My dad was not best pleased and considered destroying the system right there. He was one of those parents who would fix perceived misbehavior with physical violence and property damage. That is to say, the exact environment a 9-year-old might cope with via escapism. Over the next few years, I would slowly accumulate my tiny library of games, usually one Christmas at a time. I still have all the original hardware in working order, despite my dad's best attempts to hide or destroy them. The one exception to my collection of Pokemon titles was Final Fantasy Tactics Advance, which I firmly believe was a formative moment in my young and mythic history. Once on an overnight summer camp trip to an observatory, I borrowed one of the camp kids' Game Boy Advance and played his copy of FFTA. I did not sleep at all that night, having experienced the heady combination of neurodivergence and turn-based tactics for the first time. Anyone returning to my channel will know what became of that. As you may have observed, I did not have a good childhood. I grew up in the middle of nowhere to impoverished parents who were either abusive or abused, in ways which were tragic, but not necessarily interesting. We don't need to, and I won't go into that. Just tuck that nugget away in the back of your brain for when we start talking about the interplay of escapism and fantasy worlds, and consider that my home life was hostile to the concept of agency. Remember that all of my formative experiences with fantasy worlds came from outside my immediate household for years, up to and including owning my first system. The important takeaway here is the games were, from a young age, primed in my young mind as a form of escapism. The irony of FFTA falling into my lap does not escape me, and that cognitive dissonance is, doubtless, in no small part responsible for the video essay you're watching right now. Given the conditions that shaped my introduction to video games, it's perhaps a mathematical near certainty that I would be into fantasy and role-playing in a big way. Even before isekai became its own true cultural identifier, these genres lent themselves to escapists by creating that other world to become immersed in, and boy howdy was I in it. Skyrim was one of the first real games I played in college. At the time I graduated high school, my perception of the Xbox and PlayStation were that their target audience was adults, something I later came to realize was false. So I was keen to make the jump to Xbox when I started college in late 2011. But Skyrim wasn't actually my first game on Microsoft's console. That would have been Call of Duty Black Ops. Another era in my life I'd like to forget, and then Dragon Age Origins. DAO was my introduction to the role-playing genre proper. Put a pin in that, we're coming back to it. my experiences before this coming in the form of the mainline Pokemon series and the aforementioned Final Fantasy Tactics Advance. Not to besmirch either series, but revolutionary entries into the role-playing genre these were not, having little to no meaningful choice on narrative directionality available to the player. Dragon Age Origins, however, did, at least in some degree. Little to my knowledge at the time, that experience with agency in video games would poison much of my later perception of the Elder Scrolls. None of these thoughts were actively going through my mind when I first played Skyrim, though. I was just over the moon to be playing a grown-up game that seemed to be well-received by just about everyone. I chose High Elf as my race and followed Raelof out of Helgen, played around with the magic system just enough to get frustrated with how awful the early game mage experience is, and soon after switched to Sword and Board. I completed the Stormcloak line, only to be met with the white nationalist rhetoric that hit a little too close to home at every turn, not knowing switching sides was even a theoretical option. This is to say, almost every roleplay decision I could have made was dissonant with that which the world presented me, and was also dissonant with that which I would consider most reflective of my informed self. I was a High Elf Stormcloak sympathizer who did not engage with magic in any meaningful way. If Skyrim's lore were as developed and lampshaded as some people claim, my first playthrough should not have been one of tonal whiplash, and I must admit it left me feeling out of place. I'm getting ahead of myself here. Suffice to say, I played Skyrim a lot. So much, in fact, that I destroyed my first copy from overuse. I stripped the disc. I had to purchase a second copy of Skyrim for the Xbox, plus an internal hard drive so I could play it without spinning the disc, lest I destroy it too. Yeah, that's right. As early as 2012, I was already buying multiple copies of Skyrim. All this would later be invalidated when a group of friends twisted my arm to play Borderlands 2 with them, put a pin in that, so a third copy of Skyrim was purchased when I made that switch to PC, and an obsession with Minecraft, as it always does with neurodivergence, soon followed. Minecraft is heralded as the quintessential go-anywhere, do-anything game, and for good reason. It's peak sandbox. I create a Minecraft world and am immediately dropped into that world, naked and afraid, with no tutorial. There is no quest that prevents me from using iron tools until I confront the dragon at the Western Watchtower. There is no lock keeping me out of the Skulk Cities until I complete the Blackreach quest. The only thing that blocks, no pun intended, my access in Minecraft is my willingness to engage with the world. If I want to fuck off and build a lumber mill, or bore a 16x16 hole to the center of the earth, and then make pixel art of Hatsune Miku, rather than explore the game world, then that's my prerogative. There is no quest progression or artificial gating preventing me from doing so. Even in the use case where Minecraft structures or terrain generation blocks my access for not having strong enough pickaxes, I can still break through with my bare hands, admittedly very slowly. Slow, guided process is a key differentiation from halted progress. There is nothing stopping me from brute-forcing my exploration in Minecraft if this is the path I've divined to take. Skyrim is not so shy about artificially gating my access. Skyrim, in fact, is downright lousy with unpickable locks, sheer cliffs just slightly too high to be jumped, doors barred from the other side, or ones gated behind MacGuffins held exclusively in NPC inventories. Genuinely, this is worse than the root guard in Pokemon Red and Blue telling me he's thirsty. Truly, revolutionary installments in the You Shall Not Pass system, say nothing of the continued absence of Mark and Recall. But what does this mean? It means Skyrim is not really an open-world game. It's an open-world game provided I already have the MacGuffin needed to access the area I chose to explore. Functionally, Skyrim is just as on-rails as Dragon Age Origins. It's just less apparent because Dragon Age Origins routing prevents me from entering the vast nothingness between built playable areas, of which there are a lot, and Skyrim's routing prevents me from entering the something between the vast built nothingness, of which there is still a lot, but it's less noticeable because there's so much empty fucking land between content gates. It's like trying to navigate Branford, Connecticut in a wheelchair. You don't realize how much the sidewalk dictates your movement until you get to the pub, blocked by a single stair, forcing you to backtrack through a city populated by generously 20 people that wasn't that interesting the first time in the cold and rain for who knows how long, and it ruins your whole day. On the subject of time, Minecraft's time to onboard is effectively nil. The time it takes to go from spawning into the world to the end of the tutorial is, for all intents and purposes, my own reaction time. For an open-world sandbox, this is incredible, quintessential even. Skyrim's tutorial is, of course, the Helgen segment, which takes around 45 minutes to complete, including the wagon ride scene. 45 minutes is kind of a lot for a tutorial, but would be tolerable provided it spent that time giving me valuable information. Trouble is, it doesn't, and I do not understand anyone who says it does. Everything you need to know about combat can be provided in a single text box, and the stage setting for the world is good up until the point Alduin shows up, at which point the lore dump abruptly stops. Just to get ahead of the comments, yes, Skyrim's tutorial does do a good job of stage setting up until Alduin shows up. After that, it's an on-rail segment with no new content to add. There's an argument to be made that the choice between Hadvar and Raelof is lore in a sense, insofar as that it alerts the player to two of the game's factions, the Imperials and Stormcloaks. Ignoring that this was already introduced to the player via literally the entire Cartwright and Execution segment, place your hand on your heart and tell me, during your first playthrough of the game, when this information was the most valuable to you, how many of you knew what the difference between these two people were? How much of your decision of who to follow was governed by understanding the political weight of your choice? And how much was governed by the dragon-induced panic forcing you to take the first door you saw? The first choice in Skyrim is not a choice between factions, it's a choice between doors. How many of you, on your first playthrough, even noticed that there was dialogue between Hadvar and Raelof in front of the doors? How many of you waited outside in the rain of fire to listen to it in its entirety? There's a lot of tutorial remaining after the lore stops being meaningfully given to the player. Put a pin in that, we're coming back to it. Were Skyrim attempting to be a true open world title, it could have done so more effectively by having the player break their bindings as Alduin destroys Helgen. Perhaps Alduin's breath attack would partially damage the player, burning away the rope restraints and allowing a pop-up tutorial explaining health and healing, and then by extension a tutorial on how the player's inventory works and how to equip spells. You have to heal somehow, after all. This would then allow the player to run in whatever direction on the game world they choose, and cut a good 20 minutes out of the tutorial. It's for this reason I think the Live Another Life mod is a required install. And this is important, because when I see most people play Skyrim, they do so by exploring the overworld. I know people who only play Skyrim by exploring the overworld, because they like to roleplay a deer hunting simulator, or run around picking flowers because they enjoy the alchemy. They are of the same cloth as those individuals who install Final Fantasy XIV as an ERP engine. There is no shame in this. Balmung treaties aside, Skyrim's overworld level design, perhaps not the dungeons, has been near universally praised. And this is not a praise that I'll withhold myself. Skyrim looks, in places, beautiful. Skyrim has provided me more animated zoom backgrounds than all other games combined. You can drop me almost anywhere on Skyrim's overworld map that isn't in Falkreath Hold, and I can tell you where, within a few meters, I am on the map. Evidence of this is on my channel. I have a couple Skyrim Zero Guesser videos up. Even some caves in Skyrim managed to inspire awe, the standout obviously being that of Blackreach. This makes it all the more disappointing when, after enjoying my time on the surface, I come to an interesting-looking dungeon set piece only to be met with an impassable wall or stoic system message saying, "You lack the required item," abruptly and pointedly reminding me that the world is not in fact open. It's closed, because I explored wrongly. I found the world's beauty in the wrong order and dared to engage with this world's cardinal sin, curiosity. Most of the overworld is open, though, and perhaps that's why I find it so Moorish. As long as I, literally, only scratch the surface, the world's narrow trough is less apparent. Okay, so Skyrim is outdone by Minecraft in the open world aspect. That's fine. It's an open world action RPG, so it still has the action RPG elements to fall back on. I think even Skyrim's staunchest defenders will admit the combat system leaves a lot to be desired. Borderlands, see, I told you we'd be coming back to this, keeps combat fresh by tweaking my weapon's 5 main stats, plus 4 or 5 others that are more like binary special effects. Think this gun consumes 2 ammo instead of 1, or this gun has a knife on the end that pumps my melee damage type of deal. Plus, of course, the red text, which can be almost any kind of this gun shoots swords instead of bullets and turns my cock into a 12-pound artillery piece, wild shit you can imagine. This is to say that while Borderlands combat can be factually boiled down to pull trigger, hurt baddie, the feel of that combat differs with most weapons, even those of the same type or manufacturer, because there is so much differentiation that exists between my trigger finger and the end of the barrel. And it doesn't stop there. Borderlands has a variety of enemy types that require me to employ different tactics and armaments. There's charging enemies, fast-moving support bots that buff dangerous foes on the ground, shielded enemies that require flanking, bullet hose enemies that require cover, and Stalkers, which make me want to give myself a lobotomy by suck-starting a torque-branded shotgun. This is all ignoring weapon damage type efficacy and action skills, which, for the sake of time, I'll say are cool things and stop talking about them. Every fight in Borderlands 2 feels a little bit different. Even when I play through the game a second or a third time, it never feels like exactly the same fight, because my experience is dictated both by the gun in my hands and the enemy that face-checks the high-velocity produce. I cannot say the same for Skyrim. All melee weapons in Skyrim are functionally the same weapon that damages the enemy in functionally the same way. The only difference is damage and swing speed. There is no weapon triangle, there are no weapon skills, and no, decapitation does not count. I can't attack high or low to go under a block. I can't feint, I can't perfect block, I can't hit a foe's arm to damage their swing speed or hamstring them to prevent pursuit. There is no mace I can hold aloft to strike my enemy with holy fire. There's nothing. There aren't even 3 or 4 hit combos that may vary my attack animations. Fucking Kingdom Hearts on the Game Boy Advance had a more in-depth combat system than Skyrim, and that's saddled to an obtuse card system. Skyrim has slabs of iron with identical range and attack animations that I left-click to lazily swing across my screen to deal damage equal to the number on the stat stick to my enemy. The only variation in this entire action system is holding down the left-click slightly longer to hit a bit harder if you have the green juice for it. Theoretically, and in fairness, directional power attacks do exist, but I want you, dear viewer, to bare your soul in the same capacity as I hear. When was the last time you even attempted to use a power attack that wasn't standing or forwards, because you know in your heart of hearts that aiming with any other type of power attack is straight up impossible? The closest this game comes to a nuanced combat mechanic is power bash to disarm, which does not save this wretchedly myopic combat system. This combat system, unironically, looks like the dog shit prototype that the Patsy and Grandma's Boy failed to get working in Alpha. It's not fun. There are generously 5 unique weapons in the game that have an in-world effect that isn't just a bigger number. Okay, well, what about magic? I am playing a mage. That's more interesting and engaging, right? While there are some utility spells in Skyrim, I don't ever use them outside of a healing spell. Flesh spells are too expensive. It just nukes my mana pool and I have nothing less to fight with. I can also just, like, wear armor, much of which is going to have better spell reduction costs and chance than my proper mage kit anyway. Illusion spells just don't work on half the enemies in the game until I've already played the game for a long time. And also, like, just don't work on things that are high level. 95% of the time, I'm going to be using one of two spells, one of my destruction spells, and a heal. That's no different than firing an arrow, except instead of an infinite supply of arrows, I have a limited supply of blue juice. Functionally, I'm casting the same spell in the same way 95% of the time. That's the same gameplay loop every other weapon has. Nominally, armor exists, which makes my choice of weapon matter, as certain weapon types ignore armor. Functionally, there are only 3 types of enemies in Skyrim. Bandits, who continue using shitty light armor well into the late game. Draugr, who do not appear to have armor values at all. No, seriously, I cannot find any information on this hyper-documented game on UESP relating to Draugr armor values. I can only assume armor is not mentioned because they don't have an armor value. And dragons, which... Are you fucking kidding me? Have no armor value! Seriously, there is nothing in this game that has an armor value, and even if it did, it's not like it's going to change the way I play. I'm not going to put down my sword that I have all the perks for and equip my backup mace, which I don't carry, and beat to death the one dude in the bandit camp that bothered to wear armor today. All the while, everything is coming at me in the same way. Every enemy in Skyrim either swings a stick or throws something at me. There are no chargers, no sponges, no enemies that spawn more than one minion. You will kill the first bandit in Skyrim in the same way you will kill the 100th bandit in Skyrim, and likely with the same weapon. Every weapon is the same, every magic is the same, every enemy is the same, every build eventually becomes a stealth archer, because with a staggering 3, count them, 3 mechanics, stealth, weapon zoom, and aiming, it has 3 times the mechanics of any other combat style. And to you, yes, you little pedant, stealth daggers are not a valid form of combat until you're already in the late game, so... If you have to do some stinky cheese grind to make your build work, you're not playing the game until it does work. So no, stop writing your comment. It doesn't work. Hitherto now, I've avoided talking about dragon encounters, which are just slogs. They're so grindy, a shout exists specifically to make dragons not suck for melee builds. And it's plot relevant. You literally can't engage with this main plot's content without getting the dragons don't suck shout. It's attritive. I don't think there's another word for it. I either have gear that can out-tank a dragon's breath attack, a weapon that can out-damage the breath attack, or I run away. There isn't a clever tactic I can use here that doesn't take half an hour of edge peeking. I can't play better to deal with the dragon. It's just a numbers game. Dragons are HP pools that just run away. They're not fun. They're so not fun, it's an open secret that it's kosher to just not do Dragon Rising until you're ready to put dragons into the world. Lots of people do this. If dragon fights were fun, this wouldn't be a popular flavor of cheese. Dragons are a great source of loot, one of the best in the game, in fact. Players are willingly choosing to put fewer loot crates into their game because of what a shit sickle it is to open them. Where were we? Right. Open world action RPG. Well, the world isn't open and the action is pretty static, so I guess that leaves us with the RPG. Skyrim is primarily an RPG, but you don't have to take my word for it. Bethesda proudly wears this mantle themselves. Just look here on the store page. But it's worth asking, what agency am I given to live my chosen life? Role-playing is, to me, about immersion. It's my ability to affect the status quo of the world around me. It's my ability to suspend my disbelief that the entities populating my game world are real people, with real desires and opinions. Whereas Skyrim would take the approach of a complete overworld and few, if any, interactions with many companions, Dragon Age Origins, and I told you we'd be coming back to this, was primarily populated by content that directly contributed to its overarching narrative. Who I choose to travel with in DAO is just as critical to the world as is, well, the world. Saddle up with Sven and Morrigan, and I'll get an earful of nihilism and pragmatic snark. Pal around with Wynn and Alistair, and I'll receive some blue sky idealism. My companions have input on the world around me, their life experiences providing context other characters might be blind to. Every companion has a life that exists outside of me, the player, and if I take the time to interact with them, they will reveal that bonus lore. It makes the world feel more alive, like the people in it have a stake in this world and its events that can't be summarized by a single sentence. Finding a character in Skyrim who feels conflicted about anything is a bit of a stretch, and again, before you start typing your comment, no, Jarl Balgrif doesn't count. Apathy is not indecision, it's the decision of abstinence. Dragon Age Origins also follows the same faction questline as Skyrim. That is to say, the main quests in each game are all related to the most prominent factions of the game world. Dragon Age's take on this is in some ways similar to Skyrim. All paths play more or less the same until the final moments, when I'm given an option for a branching decision. The key difference here is that the people in DAO care about my decisions. I can ruin relationships with some companions by taking actions wholly antithetical to their beliefs. The factions that join me in the climactic final battle are not three randos I picked up 5 minutes ago after sharing a touching unskippable cutscene with hours ago and never seeing again. Instead, they vary, based on how I've interacted with the world up until now. The world is fundamentally different because my actions affected the world in a way more complex than changing the color of guard's armor. It's more insidious than that. Skyrim not only does not provide me with the option to question or affect the world around me, it mocks me for the attempt. It openly mocks my willingness to engage faithfully with the world as it's presented. I can't disagree with Aella or Farkas when they say Codlac is in the wrong to think lycanthropy is a curse. It doesn't matter that his consent has changed. It doesn't matter that he can't go to Nordheaven. I'm not upset that they don't agree with him. I'm upset that I don't have the option to reasonably dissent on my own behalf. Completely ignoring Codlac's stake in this, I should have the ability to object to lycanthropy given all of Skyrim's citizens, which includes me at the time of the initiation, are hostile to werewolves on site. Unless I'm role-playing a violent idiot or an out-and-out evil character, the roleplay of accepting lycanthropy at face value does not parse. I can't ask any kinds of questions about anything in the College of Winterhold questline. What is the Augur of Dunlane? Who are the Psijic Order and what are they doing here? Don't you think it's a good idea to maybe press the Psijics on this issue? It seems like it could be kind of a big deal. Does the Eye of Magnus have anything to do with the Knight of Tears? What about the extermination of the snow elves in Northern Skyrim? They seem like they could be related. Hey, did and I know this is a weird question, but help me out here. Did the Thalmor steal the moon? What happened to the Akavir? Or how do you know where I could find an Elder Scroll? I mean, for fuck's sake, that one's plot relevant and I can't ask about it. I swear to God, I could do this for 20 minutes on just the Mages Guild, so let's move on. I can't refuse to give my soul to Nocturnal in the Thieves Guild quest line, nor can I attempt to solve the whodunit before Mercer's reveal, despite him being the obvious culprit. And it's the same with the Dark Brotherhood. I can't identify the person messing with the Dark Brotherhood until Astrid's charred remains confess. Nor do I have the option to destroy or abandon the Night Mother and effectively replace Astrid's operation as a preferable alternative to Daedra worship. Maybe I'm cool with murder as an enterprise, but I'm less interested in selling my soul to Sithis. I can't ask Tullius why he doesn't bother learning about Nord customs if his job is, principally, to command an army with significant Nordic population and end a rebellion consisting entirely of Nordic nationals. It doesn't matter if his answer is myopic, the sin is that I can't ask. I can't ask Ulfric why he would assassinate political allies, like Torig, or why he thinks an independent Skyrim could hold off a Thalmor invasion when the entire Empire, Cyrodiil, Hammerfell, Skyrim, and High Rock, could not. Why can't I question Esbern or Delphine about the decision to kill Parthenax? Hell, why can't I pull rank? The Blades in this province are being pitched as a dragon-killing cult, not bodyguards to the Emperor. Without me, that's not possible. How do Esbern and Delphine enforce that decision? Any decision. On me. While we're at it, why don't Delphine or Esbern have comments about my choice of faction? I'm a Stormcloak and member of the Dark Brotherhood, who's killed two members of the royal family and one of their generals. How do the two remaining members of a faction still suffering the scars of eradication for their loyalty to the Emperor within living memory not have thoughts on this? Why can't I, an Imperial Talos worshipper and Dragonborn, suggest to Elisif, or Ulfric, that Skyrim press the issue of Talos worship? The Imperial government cannot practice or endorse Talos worship, but its citizens may, if only at their own peril. That's not an issue for the Dragonborn, because I'm strong as fuck. Clavicus Vile admits during his Daedric questline that I'm pretty much as powerful as him right now. Why can't I practice my faith and resist Thalmor Justiciars, which we know through environmental storytelling ambush practitioners? Why can I not suggest to my chosen High Queen or King of Skyrim, as I am explicitly Kingmaker in this universe, that openly endorsing Talos worship puts both the Empire and the Dominion in a disadvantageous position of negotiation? Hell, why can I not just fucking assassinate Tullius or Ulfric or Elisif? There is no security. I could just walk right up to them. Why can I not join the Stormcloak Rebellion, storm Solitude, take Tullius and Rikka captive, and then turn on Ulfric and declare Elisif the rightful heir to a secessionist Skyrim? By openly endorsing Talos worship without escalating the rebellion, the Empire would be forced to dedicate more resources to enforcing its will over Skyrim, compromising its already weak position with the Dominion. The Dominion would be forced to take one of two paths, either commit more resources to Skyrim, providing the Empire more opportunities for defeat and detail in the south should the Cold War turn hot. Skyrim's a long way from the Somerset Isles, making those supply lines hard to maintain. Or, the Dominion would cite Skyrim's endorsement of Talos worship as a breach of the White Cold Concordat, and force the Empire's hand to deal with those issues themselves, which means dedicating more resources to the province. All of these outcomes are preferential for Skyrim, because these lines are all resource negative for the Empire and Dominion. It strengthens Skyrim's position to bargain, Skyrim's independence, in exchange for a defensive pact with the Empire. A D-list internet celebrity once said of EU4 that you don't need to own the land to gain its benefit. Currently, Skyrim provides its military age men and women and tax revenue to the Empire. In this hypothetical agreement, the Empire retains that military, but loses the tax revenue that is currently being collected anyway because half the fucking province is occupied by a secessionist movement. Also, and let's not mince words here, Skyrim is an infertile, resource-poor shithole. Nobody has any money with Skyrim. I would be shocked if the entirety of Skyrim, Sand Solitude and the single individual that is Maven Blackbriar, generated more revenue than the single Cyrodiilic city of Skingrod. Does any of this make sense? Would any of it work? It doesn't matter. None of this matters, because none of this is in the game. Skyrim has unabashedly thrust upon me the role of Kingmaker, Savior, and Nordist of the Nords without giving me the tools necessary to vet my non-choices. Skyrim is a self-advertised role-playing game that only allows me to play a single role, the violent idiot. It comes in any color you want as long as it's black. And I don't take, oh, but it's in a lore book, as an acceptable means of inclusion. The world is, well, not teeming, as even the largest cities in Skyrim have a population that would struggle to fully staff your average Walmart, but assuredly populated. What is the purpose of an NPC in a role-playing game if not to be, decidedly, a vector for conveying place? And that feels bad, because the companions have a great setup for religious dissent. Let me talk to NPCs about whether or not someone should get to choose the afterlife they go to, or, you know, whether getting outed as a Daedra worshiper is something that they feel like doing today. The Thieves Guild has the same concept, and it goes entirely unexplored. My role in this role-playing game is irrelevant to the narrative. It needs me to be X, so I am X. That is not agency, and it's playing a role, in the same way I get to choose my ISP. I have one choice, because they're the only game in town. The Mage's Guild questline is the most interesting magical happening, including the events of the main quest, that has happened on Tamriel since the fucking moon disappeared. The Psijic Order is fascinating as a concept, an honest-to-God secret society who might have answers to really important questions. Why did the Siege of Cyrodiil suddenly stop? Where'd the fucking moon go? What is the Eye of Magnus? Why is it here? And does it have anything to do with the Night of Tears? This artifact, this thing, this fucking thing, may be one of the, if not the most important artifacts of Nordic culture in existence. And I can't ask about it in the game about fucking Nords! At all! I am living the history. My boots are in the mud. I am the man on the ground. I am the one living and doing and being the history of this continent, and I will know less about this shit than some no-name in The Elder Scrolls VI. If this is some kind of meta-commentary on inevitable ends, why are the events of the main quest incongruent with that statement? Why is it that when the Augur of Dunlane or the Psijic Order tell me, "Oh, foolish player, you cannot know. There is no need for you to know. The events are set in motion and cannot be stopped." That's taken at face value. But when Parthenax or Delphine says it, that's poppycock. I have a destiny to uphold. The events of the main quest have me make the Avatar of Time my bitch. Where do Walmart Caleb Widowgast and this glowworm in a jam jar get off telling me what is and isn't inevitable? I recently made the concept of entropy bend the knee. Skyrim is insular. A lot of Skyrim's plot is focused around Nordic customs and how they are specifically at odds with Cyrodiilic culture or doctrine. That sounds like a great chance to get someone who was born, bred, and baked in Cyrodiilic culture to give their thoughts on all this. Luckily, there's one in Skyrim. Not that I can ask him anything. How much of this is Nordic fear-mongering? Where do the Imperials say Nords are misrepresenting the situation? What is the Imperial take on the White Gold Concordat? What does the Imperial farmer whose home was occupied have to say about the war? Or the treaty? And of Ulfric, what does he have to say when pressed on the statement, "Skyrim belongs to the Nords"? It doesn't. It belongs to the Falmer and the Bretons. Why can't I talk to Ulfric about the Markarth incident, or about the Forsworn? Period. Despite being one-to-one analogous with his grassroots movement. I am the chosen one to end all chosen ones, and yet I have had no effect on this world. I am the most important individual to grace this continent since, perhaps, the Nerevarine. And yet, what substantively has changed for my presence? Yes, Alduin is gone, but so what? The dragons are still here, still attacking villages and cities in Skyrim. The overworld is unchanged. The Civil War has ended, yes, but the Imperials and Stormcloaks are still fighting. Random encounters of skirmishes still happen. Camps of Imperial or Stormcloak holdouts still persist in the hills, and their generals still can't die. I don't care if that's an oversight. It's a rising tide that further erases my fleeting footprint upon this world. I get that I can't go to Akavir to answer my questions about that culture. I'm not necessarily even upset that I can't go to Cyrodiil to get more answers about the war, much as my protestations so far may belie the contrary. I don't begrudge the game for having a limited scope. It simply was not feasible to create a game encompassing the entire continent. That I get. What I don't get is why the game was set in the province of Skyrim at all, if all the cool stuff happening around this time period is happening somewhere else. And it just keeps going. There's so much cool stuff that happens around Skyrim, the game, not the province. Why wasn't the Markarth incident the game? why wasn't the White Gold Concordat the game? Why wasn't getting involved with the Psijic Order the game? Choosing this time and place as the Elder Scrolls V setting is so myopic. There is so much cool stuff happening just off-screen, but not to me. It's happening to someone else, somewhere else, usually in Cyrodiil. Even when I'm present for history, making the discoveries, nominally forcing change, I am somehow less important to the narrative than bystanders and interlopers. There's a fantastic anecdote about the Elder Scrolls IV Oblivion where Patrick Stewart, was given an 11-page character document outlining his history and character motivations. Stewart would later say it was the best preparation for a role he'd been given to date. That character dies in the tutorial, and it's the perfect microcosm of Bethesda's approach to lore. There's an ocean of it, deep and rich, but it's not for you. It's metatextual nothing burgers that are entirely irrelevant to your experience as a player. It gives me the distinct impression that there are two factions at Bethesda. There is the cabal of writers creating world lore as though they were writing a static novel, and off in another room are the game devs, making essentially fan content, using a handful of lore tidbits they found most convenient to the project they wanted to make anyway. I cannot stress this enough. The mismatch in volume of existing lore and what I can interact with in a finished Bethesda title is disproportionate by several orders of magnitude. It's not whimsical and mysterious that there is no meaningful resolution or ability to investigate what the Sleeping Tree is, where it came from, what it does, or what impacts it has on the world at large. Rather, it's a categorical failure of Bethesda's game development skills for creating every set piece they needed to reward engaged players in the right place in the right time with the right skills for being fundamentally curious about their game world, and instead choosing to do a half-assed hint of a capital P place, a Xerox of a Xerox of a cameo, and call that world building. The world is full of fantastic sights that I will never see. It's full of living people with needs and wants and aspirations that I can never know. It's full of magic and wonder that I will experience by lazily dragging a slab of scrap iron across my screen until the magic dies, so that I can loot randomized gear from its lifeless corpse. What is the point of all this lore, all these ifs and ands and buts, this mythic history and meta-context, if my ability to interact with it is not meaningfully greater than jumping into the goddamn end portal? Beyond Skyrim, Bruma is a mod produced by a group of modders called the Arcane University. Bruma has its own tutorial section, that being the events of Fort Pale. Though unlike the base game's tutorial, I'm not forced to sit through its lore dump unless that's my preferred method of engagement. There's nothing stopping me from just walking past the set piece and exploring the entire world of Cyrodiil. Hell, I don't even need to enter Cyrodiil legally. I can skip the whole guard segment and do a dungeon crawl if that's what rustles my jimmies. It doesn't matter what my preferred method of roleplay engagement is, Beyond Skyrim has an onboarding option that is relevant to my interests. My choices are still limited, yes, but those choices reasonably cover common methods of engagement. I cannot say the same thing of the base game. Just south of Fort Pale lies Snowstone Rest, an inn housing exactly two NPCs, Erlis the Innkeep and Arnoth the Resident Bard. There are no patrons here. This bit of respite at the end of nowhere, on the face of it, contains little of interest. The main building is a single two-story structure, with a bar downstairs and a handful of single bedrooms above. Outside, I find a small shed, whose roof is barely complete, which is otherwise featureless, and a single gravestone etched with a somber epitaph to the owner's dog. While on initial viewing, one may assume the world beyond is just as barren as Skyrim, nothing here exists without purpose. The bard has dialogue about himself, snippets of the culture of Valenwood, and how it relates to his heritage, and additionally, how little he cares for me, expecting him to fill the role of video game quest giver. That in and of itself is a novelty. NPCs in Skyrim tend to speak to the player uncannily, as though their dialogue could only make sense to an individual outside the simulation. Rarely in Skyrim are any words said that aren't directly in service of the player, delivering key information about my noble quest, or otherwise happening between individuals with the understanding that I, the player, am there to conspicuously overhear it. This bard, this nobody in an optional back end of nowhere bucks that trend by directly telling me that they're not interested in me being the main character in a way that doesn't invite further engagement, which in Skyrim would normally be a fistfight. They have a life outside their relationship with me, and my God, does it feel refreshing. The innkeeper is similarly storied. He gave me a quest to gather a token offering for his dog's grave, and later a quest to find a stray dog that he can adopt. The dialogue is touching, moving in a way Skyrim rarely is, because, again, I am observing agents of this world caring about things that are not me, or what I specifically, and only I specifically, can do for them. The fantasy that this world exists, that it might continue with or without me, and I am but here to witness its quiet majesty, is strengthened by these character moments. The world informed me that I could watch this old man's prayer if I so chose, but it did not force me to do so. I toggled on my RP walk and followed Erlis to the grave behind the hut, entered sneak mode to pay my respects, which, incredibly, did not prompt Erlis to break sequence and issue stock dialogue warning me not to pickpocket him. Then left my own flowery offerings on the gravesite. There was no quest prompt for this, no call to action beyond my own immersion, yet I felt compelled nonetheless. What's the nicest flower I have in my inventory? A question I found myself asking that I never would have asked in Skyrim. My disbelief had, in that moment, been suspended. In Bruma proper, there's an old man that talked at me for 15 minutes, telling me his life story. Where he came from, his life lived, his mistakes, his triumphs, his relationship with his wife. I listened to all of it with bated breath, and I enjoyed every second. This one man has more presence in Tamriel than every faction leader in Skyrim combined. I befriended the guard captain. I made a friend. I made an actual friend. I feel like I have some understanding of his troubles, however mundane. He felt like a real person. I like him, and I care what happens to him. I care if he's having a bad day. I will go out of my way to make his life better because he bared his soul to me in confidence, and I respect that. The only quest that ever came close to capturing the sentiment in Skyrim was when Elisif requested I take Torig's Warhorn to a Shrine of Talos. But there was no world to observe, no prayer to be shared, no quiet thank you. I delivered the horn and the quest ended. Even the clothes merchant, Bruma's fucking clothes merchant, has a backstory. Beyond Skyrim, Bruma is Skyrim, insofar as my ability to change the history that I'm living is still non-existent. This I begrudgingly accept. This is hard for sandbox titles to do. I fault Bethesda for choosing that genre, not the modders who have to work with that faulty framework. But Beyond Skyrim, Bruma does let me roleplay. I can tell characters that they're being an idiot. I can, at least sometimes, ask about ideological differences. There are NPCs I can go to, the Friar, random old men, who will talk about their feelings for several minutes. I may not be able to affect this world, but I still care about the people in it. Skyrim was never what it said on the tin. It's a restrictive open world, its action is rigid, and its roleplay is downright insulting. So why do I keep playing this fucking game? I've been thinking about this a lot, and I do mean a lot. It's been the thought that's dominated my unquiet mind for the past several months. And while I'm not entirely satisfied with the answer I've come up with as a process of writing the script, I do have what I think is a workable paradigm. Beyond Skyrim attempts to engage with me at the level at which I engage with it. This bit of Skyrim that isn't Skyrim, crafted by individuals who clearly have stake and purchase in the source material, has an understanding of both what Skyrim is, but also what they think it should be. It's fiction written to be tested, experienced, played with, in a fashion more complex than that of a sightseer's log. That is to say, it's a video game. When I play Skyrim, I have this uncanny feeling that when I walk by, everyone is looking at me as though I realize that I'm the dreamer in my own dream, that I am the center of this universe, and when I walk past, the world ceases to exist. It almost feels as though if I could whip my head around fast enough, I would see the faux humans re-jellify from non-existence. That feeling is significantly less present in Beyond Skyrim in a way that lets me believe the fantasy I attempt to live in may be tangible. Beyond Skyrim, Cyrodiil, ostensibly, lets me experience Skyrim better than Skyrim ever did. I find myself here on the shore of Lake Rumair, feeling a sense of purpose, calling. Like the incomplete and unsatisfactory experience I subjected myself to in the dead world of Skyrim might be given closure if only I could cross the lake. I've always felt a kind of kinship with the Empire. I think I like, on paper, what they stand for, or at least the version of them presented to me in Skyrim. It's my understanding that the Empire was, pre-Oblivion, morally dubious, a mantle which Oblivion shed in favor of a more accessible narrative. Which, if true, is exactly what I mean when I say this world is full of magic I will never interact with. I think Cyrodiil, the Imperial City, is symbolic of what I wish Skyrim would have been, what it should have been, what it had the potential to be. I fully expect to be disappointed when I reach the Imperial City. The monolith that I've built it as in my head is a height that I can't expect anyone to reach, but I still have to go. Maybe once I get there, I can finally stop asking myself why Cyrodiil wasn't the setting of The Elder Scrolls V in the first place. Maybe I, an Imperial native to Skyrim, witnessed the events of Skyrim and found it lacking. Found myself bored and unwelcome in my own province, and just want to experience the fantasy of coming home to people who were doing something when I wasn't looking. At the start of all this, I said, Skyrim plays like diaspora-flavored Sprite with taste, and while I stand by that personal metaphor, it might be more accurate to say Skyrim plays like fast food tastes, specifically McDonald's, the type of mass-appeal, unimaginative product that's easily approachable but not particularly gratifying. I love the idea of McDonald's. When I think about ordering, my brain gives me the happy chemical, and then when I start eating, I'm reminded of why I don't like McDonald's very much. The nuggets are soggy on the outside and dry on the inside. The burger is beef, I guess, but doesn't contain any of the umami mouth-filling flavors or textures that I expect of a meat product. The bun is doing a lot of heavy lifting here, and even it tastes a bit like an old hot dog bun. The fries are perhaps the most poignant. With the first bite, I get the impression that these may have once been enjoyable had I eaten them fresh out of the fryer, but I didn't. I got them after 10 minutes of travel time, and now they're a bit soggy and sad. They're lukewarm, despite the weather between me and the restaurant being in the upper 80s Fahrenheit, and I find myself wondering if I shouldn't just throw them out. In the trip to the trash, I find myself reliving the whole cycle over again, thinking how much I would enjoy some Macca's right now, despite all of my senses actively giving me tangible evidence to the contrary. It's much the same with Skyrim. I love the idea of Skyrim. I like thinking about the lore implications and the what-ifs. I like theory crafting about what kind of build, insofar as such a thing can exist in Skyrim, would be fun to play. What if I tried bound weapons this time, or what if I finally tried an illusion-based character? I love the idea of being on the plains west of Whiterun and having the potential to go anywhere in Skyrim's open world. And then I load into the game, and I'm immediately reminded how I don't like Skyrim very much. How I have several hours of doing the same quests I've always done ahead of me before I achieve anything resembling how I'd imagined I'd be spending my time. There's a few items I'll want in every run, and a few more that I don't want in every run, but keep getting anyway, because I find myself sitting in the overworld thinking, okay, I'm here. Now what do I do? I want to do something productive for my character, and so I end up falling back on the same series of quests. I'm not an alchemist, at least not this time, but getting the white file seems like progression, so I'll do that quest. I'm not particularly interested in Dibella or Mara, but hey, 10% bonus healing and damage to the opposite sex is progression, so I'll do those quests. These quests are all pretty quick and not particularly offensive. I mean, they're fetch quests by another name. But in engaging with them, I come to the realization that this describes the entirety of Skyrim. It's all quick and inoffensive in a way not unlike that Minecraft experience. The brief and sharp intrusion of what can only be by the loosest definitions called roleplay are over quickly, and I'm left in what is, in effect, a sandbox that's been stripped to the studs. 8 bleary hours later, I close Skyrim. only within the last half hour have I gotten the two or three perks needed to make the character fantasy I wanted to play with possible. For the other 7.5 hours, I was not living another life. I was not role-playing. I was living the same life, doing the same quests, doing the same grind. I was the same mage I've been 100 times before. I was the same warrior I've been 100 times before. I was briefly the same two-handed specialist I've tried to be 6 times before, receiving the harsh reminder that two-handed weapons are for chumps, who look at the static combat system clearly defined by having two hands and deciding they only want to use one. I did not enjoy the last 8 hours. I spent the last 8 hours as one would spend a resource. I was entertained, if only by the strictest definition of the term, but at no point was I having fun. Maybe that's why Skyrim works so well as an escapist entry. It requires nothing of me but my presence. I don't need to think about the world, any world, mine or the one being presented to me, at all. I can turn my brain off and not meaningfully impact my ability to exist within the game space. The world is so bland and inoffensive that it's just background noise. Skyrim in this instance is serving the same function as the Family Guy reruns put on at family gatherings. Nobody's watching that shit, but it's noise. It's something. It's flashing lights and color that give the vague impression that something might be happening, and above all, it's a brief distraction from things I'd rather not be dealing with. When I finished Beyond Skyrim Bruma, cleared all the quests, found no undone content left on the wiki, I sat. I found myself taking ritualistic actions, practiced, unthinking, like one might do walking to the bathroom at night with no light. And before I knew it, I was in the air again, no clip toggled, gazing over the Imperial City, this time not from the southern border at Falkreath, but from the far shore of Lake Rumaire in County Bruma. I felt at once in another place, back in my dorm room at college, looking into my 10-inch TV, precariously suspended by a broken coat hanger from a plank of wood under the top bunk of my bed. I was again a High Elf Stormcloak sympathizer, except not. I was someone else this time. But in that moment, I remembered all the individual actions that brought me to that moment, separated in space and time to arrive at the same capital P place, separated by 10 years of life and similar years of introspection. I stared into the horizon as only the lost can. I felt compelled, pulled, like an elf to Valinor. I feel like I'm in the shower, and even though the water hasn't changed temperature, it's somehow less inviting. And I know I have to step out, forward, and leave the province, the zeitgeist and the albatross of Skyrim behind me, because immersing myself in a boring world to escape an inconvenient one is self-destructive. Skyrim isn't fun. It's addictive. It's designed from the ground up to be as accessible and inoffensive as possible, having just enough substance to keep players engaged without fulfillment. Playing Skyrim feels less like an act of recreation than it does one of habit. I don't want these fucking chicken nuggets. I don't know why I bought them. It seemed like a good idea at the time, despite thousands of hours of experience telling me it's going to feel like recreational sedation. I keep playing this game because it's addictive. It's not romantic. It's the video game equivalent of fast food slop, and I get sucked into it because that's the way my neurodivergent brain deals with stress. The modding community has done so much with so little, and that's why this is so frustrating. Skyrim has all the individual pieces it needs to be fulfilling, and it chooses not to because it's easier to write content. Not narrative, not engagement, not immersion. Content. Everything I enjoy about Skyrim isn't Skyrim. It's the metatext of Skyrim. It's all the lore, deep and rich, that for all intents and purposes does not exist in the single product it was written to create. It's the passion and attention to craft of Michael Kirkbride. It's mods and the modding community. It's every member of the Arcane University and every countless modder who fills an empty sandbox with character. Modders somehow draw blood from this stone to make something that I do, against all odds, remember fondly. It's people. The answer was always people. People making art and things they enjoy, expressing their passions. It's so easy to blame the Radiant AI system for all of Skyrim's ills, but that's just a symptom of a larger problem. Senior leadership consciously chooses the role-playing label and advertises to that audience, while providing none of the tools necessary to live any life except the one demanded by a static story about the least interesting thing happening in this time period, full of myopic characters that feel like the artifacts of a waking dream that has no consequences for myself or the world, all while shunning introspection at every step. I glance over to this evening's McDonald's chicken nuggets left uneaten. Because despite the great value for money, they just give you too many of these things. I can never finish them in one sitting. They're stale now. The once soggy breading is now well and truly flaccid. The chicken no longer tastes of chicken. It's more akin to the chicken version of the kind of scrambled eggs served in cafeterias. And the whole ensemble now tastes homogenous. There's no difference in texture between the breading and chicken. This meat wad is now well and truly one entity with no depth, which can be fully experienced in a single unsatisfying mouthful. There's a lot of it, more than I can meaningfully experience at once, and tonight I'll feel like I could have done better.